Thank you. स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। नमस्कार टू ऑल ऑफ यू, वेलकम टू द स्टडी ऑफ द लाइफ ऑफ शारदानंद जी महाराज, वन ऑफ द डायरेक्ट डिसिपल्स ऑफ श्री रामकृष्ण। वी हैव ऑलमोस्ट कंप्लीटेड 90% ऑफ द लाइफ ऑफ शारदानंद जी महाराज। वी विल कंटिन्यू फ्रॉम वेयर वी हैड लेफ्ट इन द लास्ट क्लास। One disciple of Sharadananda ji Maharaj asked him the question, Swamiji, we do not see God. How can we love Him without seeing Him? How can we love a being who is unseen and whose very existence is doubtful? Very pertinent question, which all of us will have this doubt in our mind. Question is also very important. We'll go through that question again. One of the disciples of Swami Shardananda ji Maharaj is asking Shardananda, Swamiji, we do not see God. How can we love God without seeing Him? How can we love a being who is unseen and whose very existence is doubtful? Now, Sharadananda ji Maharaj is replying to this question. Act according to the instructions of the Guru. That means have faith in the words of the Guru. Act according to the instructions of the Guru. If you can strictly follow what the Guru has prescribed for the realization of God, everything will be smooth at last. Meditation comes afterwards. If one fails to meditate, one should go on repeating the mantram very earnestly. Now, when the disciple asked the question, Swamiji, we do not see God, how can we love Him without seeing Him? How can we love a being who is unseen and whose very existence is doubtful? First of all, Sharadananda ji Maharaj is telling, act according to the instructions of the Guru. If you can strictly follow what the Guru has prescribed for the realization of God, everything will be smooth at last. Meditation comes afterwards. If one fails to meditate, one should go on repeating the mantra very earnestly. To another disciple B who was there, do you follow what the Guru has instructed you? Whoever practices even half of what the Guru has instructed if you practice, surely you will get the result. Even if you practice half of what Guru has instructed you, surely you will get the result. Do you know Purascharana of the mantra? It means a mantra becomes conscious. That is, the mantra has the potential energy. The energy, the power is hidden inside that mantra. If that has to become awakened or manifested, or that potential energy of the deity इष्ट देवता हैज टू बिकम काइनेटिक मैनिफेस्टेड देन यू हैव टू परफॉर्म पुरश्चरण. इट मीन्स ए मंत्रम बिकम्स कॉन्शियस अवेकंड काइनेटिक व्हेन यू रिपीट इट 100 टाइम्स, सॉरी 100,000 टाइम्स अ डे. When you repeat the mantra 100,000 times a day, then that mantra becomes kinetic. The power of the deity becomes manifested. The repetition of the mantram in a proper spirit even once purifies the mind. Instantly the mind fills with delight and becomes blissful. Now let me take you through the word called purascharana. Purascharana is a way of repeating the mantra which has been given to you by the guru. Suppose there are certain number of alphabets. You just take the example of Gayatri mantra. We are repeating Gayatri mantra or Savitri mantra. We all know about that. It has 24 alphabets. Bhuhu bhuvaha suvaha tat savituhu varenyam bhargaha devasya. So like that we have 24 alphabets in it later. So like that your guru will have given the mantra of the Ishta Devata. You go on counting it. How many alphabets are there? Then if you perform, now Gayatri has 24 letters. If you perform 24 crore, what is crore? It's the Indian way of counting the numericals. I will just take you through that. Units, tens, hundred, thousand, 10,000. Then in the Western system it goes to 100,000. But in the Indian system, it becomes after the 10,000, 1 lakh. Then the next digit, if you add lakh, 10 lakh, then comes crore, 1 crore. So now, what is this 1 lakh? Unit, tens, 100,000, 10,000, 100,000. Then it is million. Then 10 million. Like that, our Indian system is unit, tens, 100,000, 10,000, lakh, 10 lakh, crore. So that is the unit, 1 crore. So here 24 letters are there in Gayatri Mantra. I'm just taking the example of Gayatri Mantra. The mantra which your guru gives will be much less. It's like we have the Shadakshari or Panchakshari mantra. So, Om Namah Shivaya. It's called Shadakshari. Some people call it Panchakshari, removing Om from it. So, Shadakshara means 6 letters are there in Om Namah Shivaya. Now, we have another mantra, Om Namo Narayanaya. If you count Om, Namo Narayanaya. So, that is Ashtakshari, 8 letters. So, like that, whatever guru has given you the mantra, if you count it carefully, there will be 5 or 6 letters there. So if you perform 6 crore mantra, repeat it 6 crore times, you need not do that all together at once. You can divide. Now 6 crores are there. You can divide it in this fashion. Every day, what's your capacity? How much can you do? 5,000, 10,000. Okay, let us tell you can perform 10,000 japas every day. But in Purushcharana, you have to note, you have to keep up the place and the time regularly. Suppose today you have done it in Johannesburg, then tomorrow in Delhi, or day after tomorrow in Chennai, and the next day in Durban. So that will not be Purushcharana. In Purushcharana, when you start that Purushcharana, you have to start and do it at the same place. Suppose you have done it in your house, started it to do in your shrine. Then you have to do that in your shrine and close it, finish that in your shrine room only. So you started in it in your room, the same asana, same place, you have to do that. So now you can divide the whole day, even that month, how much can you do? 10,000. Okay, then divide it into morning 5,000, evening 5,000. Okay, you cannot do that, even 5,000. Okay, divide it into 3 times or 4 times. Morning 2,000, then at 11 o'clock, some 2,000. That is when you get some break for your tea or for your lunch. Then in the evening before tea, another 2,000. Then in the sunset during the twilight, Sandhya, Sayam Sandhya, when we do our Arati, 2,000, the night before lunch, 2,000. So like that you can divide. You see your capacity and then divide. So in that fashion, if you do every day 10,000, so how many days will it take to complete that particular number? Suppose it is 6 crores or 6 letters. So you have to do 6 crore times. So you divide it by that number of time. Every day 10,000 divided by so many days, so many crores. So it will show you. So that many number of days you have to do in the same place, and timings to your maintain. Suppose you have started in the timing today morning and evening. Then the whole period completing that that number of crores, you should do in that fashion itself, daily, morning and evening. Or if you have done it, start with 3 times a day or 4 times a day, you have to continue that. The same pattern. You should not change the place, you should not change the timings. Whatever you start. So now if you do this in this fashion, Purushcharana, complete that crore, akshara laksha or akshara koti. If you do akshara laksha, lakhs, 100,000 times per day, then it will be awakened, Purushcharana. If you do crore, then whatever desire you have to realize God, to get something, to cure your disease, or to cure somebody else's disease, you want to build a temple, you want something, permission to be got, you can fulfill your desires. So many mothers and many people used to come to me in India asking, Swamiji, we have this problem, that problem, especially mothers to be concerned about their family. Many mothers in India used to come to me that their child or their children are not performing well in education. They're not staying properly, whether they will be passing the 12th grade is doubtful, whether they can pass or get good marks in their 10th grade is doubtful. Or recently, one mother had made phone call to me that she wanted I should do the prayer and japa for her son to pass his master's in medical science. He's finished his doctorate, or he's a doctor already, wanted to complete the PG. So like that, so many desires will be there. So whatever the mantra your guru has given, you do this, complete this purushottama, the desire will be fulfilled. So I have seen with my own eyes, I have seen it. Many mothers, many devotees in India, when they used to come and ask me, please, this has to happen. I told you, have that energy within you. You have that mantra, Kalpavriksha, the wish yielding tree, wish yielding cow in the form of Kalpataru or Kalpavriksha or Kalpa Kamadenu. You have with you, the Guru has given you the mantra. Do that Purushottama, you can achieve it yourself. Why do you want to depend upon me or somebody else? Okay, I can also try. But it will be more effective, efficacious, if you yourself will do. And any time, you need not depend upon me or anybody else. You can do it. You can achieve it. Start it. That I have seen that mother, the son was going astray, was almost about to become a drug addict, or he would not pass the 12th grade. Then that child miraculously passed in high ranking for high marks. And after that, again the mother came. So now he has to get a very good seat in engineering. Then he has to pass that too. Told, it is with you. Start doing yourself. You can get it. Especially the mothers will have a lot of faith. Whatever you tell, they will do. Not all, few of them. So they do it. And they started doing it. And so many things happen. Not one, two, three, four. Even now, I make them do this purushottama, ask them to do. So whatever the guru has given the mantra with that instruction, if you perform so many crores of time, whatever the number, letter, alphabets, so you can fulfill your desires. Anything in your life, you can do that. It is in your own hand. And you are running here and there. So much power is there in your mantra. You can achieve it. Whatever desire you have, you can achieve it. So much powerful that mantra is. And now I'm telling that generally I don't tell these things in the public, only when they ask me, when they have the personal problems, they come and tell, I tell, do this and you'll get it. Because Sharadanandaji Maharaj, the direct disciple himself, has mentioned about purushottama, I gave him the details. So you see, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling, do you follow the guru, what the guru has instructed you? Who practices even half of what the guru has instructed? If you practice half even of what the guru has instructed, surely you will get the result. Then Sharadanandaji Maharaj himself is mentioning, one of the greatest of the direct disciples. So it is very, very powerful teaching. Do you know purushottama of the mantra? It means a mantra becomes conscious, kinetic, powerful, awakened, jagrata. When you repeat it 100,000 times a day, the other way, because weak-minded people will be there, they cannot do. For strong-minded people, you can perform 100,000 a day. Holy Mother used to do 1,500. 100,000 plus another 50,000. Sometimes even 200,000 a day, Holy Mother used to do every day with all the work. And that was not for her own something fulfilling the desire. It was just purely out of love of God she used to do that. And for others, her disciples too. So do you know what is purushottama? I have told you what is purushottama is. It means a mantra becomes conscious, kinetic, jagrata, when you repeat it 100,000 times a day. You can't do 100,000, you can divide like this way. The same place, same time. So daily if you can do morning, evening or morning, noon, evening or morning, noon, evening and night. So based on your capacity, divide it. And then perform it complete, akshara, lakshara, akshara, koti. How many letters are there? So to clear it, to make you still further understand, I'll give the example of purushottama done by one great rishi, one of the greatest of Shankaracharya. Now, whoever becomes the pontiff, the head of the one mutt, specially started by Shankaracharya, the Adi Shankara, the original Shankara. So whoever is the sannyasin there or the pontiff will be called as Shankaracharya. But Adi Shankaracharya is the original one. So now, this one of the Shankaracharyas in Sringeri Math, his name was Vidyaranya. He has written that famous book for sannyasins and so many other things, Panchadashi, all that Vedantic text manuals, all of the rules and regulations for the sannyasins, everything. A very beautiful book has been written by that great soul, that great Shankaracharya, Vidyaranya. Now, at that time, the Islamic invasion happening in India. Horde of Islamic invaders coming from different places like Arabia, Afghanistan, Kazakhstan, so different places, Turkey. Hordes of them are coming to loot India because there were a lot of gold and other diamonds in the temples. So they were destroying the temples. They had already destroyed so much of all the temples and Hinduism in North India. They had conquered a lot of part. Lot of Indian, North Indian. So they were now coming down south to. At the time, Vidyaranya, the Shankaracharya was here, was alarmed the way the Islamic invaders were coming down to India. So he wanted to start protect his Hinduism. He wanted to start a kingdom which would protect Hinduism. He wanted to build a kingdom, strong Kshatriyas to stop invaders. What did you do? What can, how can you do? Is sannyasin, poor sannyasin, he doesn't have money. He doesn't have anything. How can he build an army? Can he build a kingdom? So what did he do? You can get anything by spirituality. So he started doing Purushcharana. Now the word is there, Purushcharana. Of what? Gayatri Mantra. So how many times? Can you imagine? I've tried doing maximum number of Gayatri Mantra Purushcharana before getting sannyasa. We are supposed to do Purushcharana of the Gayatri. So I tried my level best, whatever I did the whole day without doing any other thing. I could complete only 8,000 Gayatri Mantras per day. I couldn't go above that. Whatever somersault or whatever I tried, I couldn't go above 8,000. Very rarely I would reach 10,000 per day, Gayatri Mantra. So before sannyasa, we are supposed to do Purushcharana. So I tried it. So now this Vidyaranya, he performed. Now there are 24 letters, alphabets in Gayatri. And Purushcharana is 24 crore times. Can you imagine? I told you, it's very, very difficult with all, giving up all the work if you do Gayatri Mantra. I couldn't go more than 8,000. Maximum I could reach 10,000. Maximum, I couldn't do that 10,000 every day. 8,000 was the one which I could reach. All the effort. So Vidyaranya performed that 24 crores times of Gayatri Mantra because it has 24 letters. So it took him maybe 5-6 years or something every day. As I told you, how you should do at the same place, at the same time, the same asana, you have to do that. You can get up and go for work, but the time and that place has to be maintained. Then only that Purushcharana will be there. And before starting the mantra, each time you have to do the sankalpa. What is sankalpa? I am doing this japa. Oh Lord, grant me this boon. For this purpose I am doing. So I am doing this japa, Purushcharana, for the sake of fulfilling this desire. So if you do this sankalpa, whatever language, you generally they do in Sanskrit, sankalpa is done. This day, this time, this nakshatra, this masa, so this sthiti, I'll be performing this for the sake of this. So that is sankalpa. So now, you have to pray to the Lord. This is the sankalpa. You can pray whichever language, mother tongue you have. I'm doing this Purushcharana for this purpose. So now, this great Vidyaranya, one of the Shankaracharyas, he did that for maybe 6 years or 10 years or 12 years. He completed Purushcharana, 24 crores. I told you, unit 10, 100,000, 10,000, lakh, 10 lakh crore. Maybe 10 million. 10 million times of Gayatri he did into 24. So it is 240 million times Gayatri in 6 or 10 or 20 years. Now, after performing that Gayatri, Mother Gayatri didn't give him darshan or the deity, whichever he did it. He couldn't get the darshan. He was very much upset. What the scriptures have written that if you do the Purushcharana, you are going to get the result, the vision of the deity, and the deity will grant you the wish. Then a ashareera vani, a formless voice uttered, in your last life or some other life, you had performed one of the Mahapatakas, maybe Gohatya or Stri Hatya or something like that, which is called a Mahapataka. There are Pancha Mahapatakas, great sins. So in some of your life, you had performed that. Whatever you did now got neutralized to that. That Papa or that particular Mahapataka or sin, because of your performance, it got neutralized. Then he started it again, Purushcharana. Again, maybe 10 or 12 years, he took it and did completed it. 24 crores. But your mantra, which is given by your guru, will be less number, 5 letters or 6 letters. If you do that, I think you can finish it in maybe 6 months or 7 months or even 3 months, based on your capacity. So now he again started the Purushcharana of Gayatri Mantra. 24 crore times, and he completed it. Then he got the vision of Divine Mother Gayatri, and she told, what do you want? Why did you do that? This is my sankalpa. I want to build a kingdom to stop the invaders who are coming, the Islamic invaders, to destroy India. So they had completed coming to South India too. So he was in South India. Then the Mother Gayatri took the form of Lakshmi and gave him a lot of gold, jewel, and diamonds, and so much of things, wealth. Now, with this money, you build an empire and protect your country, your kingdom. So he caught hold of two, Harihara and Bukka, or Hakka and Bukka, who were converted, forcibly converted to Islam. He reconverted them to Hinduism. And he started building army, collecting all the strong young people, and the empire was built, and he gave the proper time. That was called Vijayanagara Empire in South and also Central India. It covered almost, it went up to North India too. So it protected for 300 years. That Vijayanagara Empire was there for 300 years. Afterwards, it was destroyed. That was a different thing. But it was there for 300 years. And it protected Hinduism, not allowing the Islamic invaders to come down to South India. They protected it for 300 years. Why? Because it was of the tapasya, the Purushcharana of Gayatri of one sadhu, one Shankaracharya of Sringeri, Vidyaranya. Can you imagine? 300 years that empire stood. So your desire in your house to protect your daughter, to bring her to the right path, or protect your son for his education, or for your well-being of your husband, or good practice of your husband or wife, or anybody, health of somebody. If you do this Purushcharana, the mantra will be awakened, and it will fulfill your desires like a kalpatru. So you have everything in your own hand in the form of the mantra given by your guru. Generally, they will ask you to, the guru will ask you only to use it for spiritual purposes. That is to realize God. So Purushcharana, awakening, I have told you in the general way what it is, and our great Vidyaranya used it for protection of Hinduism. So even that place, the very place where he did that Purushcharana, is still there. As I told you, from Bangalore, if you go 250 kilometers, there is a place called Hoskote. And that is a dam, Tungabhadra river. On the right side of the river is one district, that is Bellary. So there we have this Hampi, the empire, the capital of the kingdom, Vijayanagara Empire, is still there. And on the left side of the river is the birthplace of Hanuman, that is Kishkindha, is still there. You can go and see it if you want, the birthplace of Hanuman, 250 or 200 kilometers from Bangalore. So there on the other side, there is a Sarovara, Pampa Sarovara, where Pampa Devi, an avatar of Divine Mother Parvati, had taken a human body. She did tapasya long back, even before Ramachandra came to that place. Ramachandra, while coming down in search of Sita, he came to Kishkindha. So there is one Shiva temple called Virupaksha Swami. Lord Ramachandra worshipped Lord Shiva there. And he stayed in one cave for 2 months, Ramachandra and Lakshmana. And he made friendship with Sugriva, Hanuman. They met Hanuman. All that happened. All those things are there in Kishkindha. If you go there, you can see everything. So there was one Sarovara, Pampa Sarovara, where she did tapasya. So it was, that was the place where, on that bank of that Sarovara, Hanuman met Ramachandra. And there, this Vidyaranya, some 600 or 700 or 800 years back, or even more, he did tapasya to get this, to do this Purasharana, and got Lakshmi to give all that wealth to build an empire. That place is also, I went to that place, Lakshmi temple is also there, where Vidyaranya did that tapasya and got the vision of Mother Lakshmi and got so much of gold and wealth and everything to build that kingdom. That Lakshmi temple is even now there. I have visited that temple too. So by Purasharana, the mantra will become awakened, powerful. Then you can get anything out of it. Awakened. Do you know Purasharana of the mantra? It means a mantra becomes conscious, kinetic, when you repeat it 100,000 times a day. Or else, I told you how to perform. The repetition of the mantra in a proper spirit even once purifies the mind. Instantly, the mind fills with delight and becomes blissful. That is the power of the mantra. Now, the disciple is asking the next question. What is the meaning of our mantra? So, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is the guru. He has given him the mantra with the Bijakshara, with the Pranava, and the name of the deity, and sometimes they may add Namaha or may not add Namaha, whatever they have done. Awakened mantra, the Guru, the Sharadanandaji Maharaj used to give. So this disciple is asking Sharadanandaji Maharaj, what is the meaning of our mantra? You have given mantra to us. What is the meaning of our mantra? So now you can all get, because most of you who are initiated in the Ramakrishna order, it will be similar. So by this answer, you can know what is that mantra too. So carefully hear what Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling about that mantra. What is the meaning of our mantra, which Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling? May God, who is the creator, sustainer, and dissolver of the universe, remove my sorrows. This is the significance of all mantras. Note it. May God, who is the creator, sustainer, and dissolver of this universe, remove my sorrows. This is the significance of all mantras. So, note it. Of all mantras, this is the significance. What is that? May God, who is the creator, sustainer, and dissolver of this universe, remove all my sorrows. So that is the significance of not only any particular mantra, but of all mantras. This is the significance of all mantras. Then how can you get anything out of it? Have faith. Shraddha. Shraddhavan labhate jnanam. Bhagavad Gita shloka. Have faith in God. Otherwise, if you don't have faith in God, if you don't have faith in the words of the Guru, otherwise, even thousands of explanations will be of no use. So it will fructify. It will give you result only if you have faith. Pray to Him and love Him. Shabda experienced the truth and realized God. So His words were very convincing. Many monks would come to Him to solve their spiritual as well as other problems too. Swami, Shardishtananda, the famous disciple of Holy Mother Sharda Devi, who had served Mother Sharda Devi for many, many years, wherever she went, whether in Jayarambati or Bodhan, wherever mother used to go. He was a very young boy at the time. He used to be there with her always. So go with mother, serve her in all the ways. So he was also the disciple of Mother Sharda Devi. So now this Swami Sharadeshananda, one of the disciples of Mother Sharda Devi, he is recalling his experience with Sharadananda, Sharad Maharaj. What is Sharadeshananda Maharaj telling about Sharad Maharaj? Once there was a discussion in front of him about a popular religious teacher. So in front of Sharadanandaji Maharaj, there was a discussion about a popular religious teacher. This teacher, religious teacher, used to have ecstatic moods, but his character was not good. But his character was bad, was very bad, scandalous. So many people were attracted to him at first because of the external gorgeous and other things, and is showing off ecstasies. So people were at first attracted to his external behavior, but internal character was not scandalous. Many people were attracted to him at first. But later on, some of them, after coming in closer contact with him and getting to know of his private life, characterless life, began to circulate the true stories. One of our brother monks even expressed his appreciation of the teacher's ecstatic moods, although he knew his character to be very bad, to which Swami Sharadananda, hearing the monk's praise, began to scold him with strong words. Do not think that only ecstatic moods indicate a very high state in religious life. What is very, very essential, even if you don't have any visions, even if you don't have any ecstasies, even if you don't have any deep meditation or any other external, what, walking in the air or a miraculous power or even astral travel, you might have nothing of such things, the external things. But if your character is good, purity of mind is very, very important. So Sharadanandaji is scolding that monk and telling, what is the important thing in spiritual life? Do not go after these external ecstasies and other things, miracles and other things. Do not think that only ecstatic moods indicate a very high state in religious life. So what is very, very important? So we have to decide here. We will be always having this queer idea or peculiar idea that we didn't have some visions, we didn't have some ecstasies and all those things. But what is important is we have purity of mind, we have unselfishness, we have good character, and nothing to worry, you are on the safe path, progressing very fast. That is very important. So Sharadanandaji is clearing what is very important in spiritual life. Do not think that only ecstatic moods indicate very high state in religious life. But what is important in spiritual life is pure character alone is the basis of religious life. Pure character alone is the basis, is the foundation, is the basis of religious life. Without pure character, who can retain all these ecstatic moods? Ecstatic moods cannot endure without pure good character. You know, in Rajyoga, in Patanjali Maharshi's Rajyoga, it is given, you can get any of these experiences, like ecstasies or whatever are there, by drugs, by so many other ways you can get chemicals, by drugs and other things. But that ecstasy or that experience which will sustain is by pure character only, which will be yours, which you can get at any time, is by pure character only. For example, David Humphrey. He is a chemist. He was explaining to his students in his class about nitrous oxide, laughing gas. He was explaining in exposure, you inhale the nitrous oxide, or laughing gas, you'll start laughing. But whatever in that jar or lid, he inhaled more nitrous oxide. So he went into sort of this test, stood there without moving you. Really, literally, it will make you laugh. Now he took a little overdosage, stood there for a long time. He didn't come out of it. When he came out of it after a long time, then he told, I started seeing the world's ideas. I couldn't see what the world in this format. I started experiencing the whole world as ideas, principle ideas. So let's see, by inhaling that, a short time he had vision, vision or ecstasy. So even chemicals or drugs or any such substance can induce. But without pure character, purity of life can't sustain it. And that is also dangerous. So that's why, what is the simplest and easiest way? Pure character, good nature. That is very, very important in spiritual life. Rest, all those other things, external things, are secondary. What is primary? Purity. So do not think that only external goods indicate high state in religious life. Pure character alone is the basis of religious life. Without pure character, who can retain all these external goods, not endure without a pure good character? On another occasion, Sharadeshanandaji Maharaj, the Holy Mother's disciple, is asking, I asked him, the real meaning of God vision, what is the real meaning of vision of God, God vision, or realization of God, what is the real meaning of it? Is it seeing something with physical eyes externally, or is it feeling something inside our inner self? Which Sharadeshanandaji Maharaj said, it is the realization of feeling something inside our inner self. But you know, when we see something with our eyes or hear something with our ears, we become firmly convinced about its existence. But inner realization gives us an even greater conviction of true eternal reality. This is the realization of God vision. And Sharadeshanandaji Maharaj, one of the disciples of Holy Mother Sharadeji, asked him, on another occasion, I asked him the real meaning of God vision or realization. Is it seeing something with physical externally or feeling something inside our inner self? To which Sharadeshanandaji Maharaj replied, God vision or realization is the realization of feeling something inside our inner self. You know, when we see something with our eyes or hear something with our ears, we become firmly convinced about existence of God. But inner realization gives us a greater conviction, faith, than what you see with your eyes and ears through your senses. So, but inner realization gives us even greater conviction of the true eternal reality. That is realization of God. That is vision of God. Now, move to the next phase of Sharadeshanandaji Maharaj's life. And what is that? Last years, How did Sharadanji Maharaj his last years? Sharadananda is a going example of a person who keep his mind in God constant, or the self, that is your Atman. Then, and at the same time, his hands at work. So he had established himself in pure character and spirituality to such an extent that Sharadanandaji Maharaj was a glowing example of a person who could keep his mind always in God or his Atman self, and at the same time his hands at work. So he could do all his work externally. So much of work he used to do externally with his all Karmendriya, organ of action, organ of senses, the mind, who constantly lived in God. So as a glowing example of always keeping his mind and senses in God, Shama, Dhamma, Upati. But at the same time, he could do all the work of the world. So he was a glowing example of a person who could keep his mind in God or Atman, and at the same time his hands at work. A real yogi. He was a real yogi par excellence. A real yogi regards the self, that is Atman, as actionless. Even while being engaged in action. How is that? Can an example be given? This is direct from the teachings of Ramana Maharshi, one of the great Jnanis who lived in Thiruvannamalai, very popular Ramana Maharshi. He tells, how can the Atman be actionless while the body, mind, other things are so active? So Ramana Maharshi explains that, giving the example of now sitting in the train and moving. Do not move, you will be sitting there on the chair, your own chair, reserved chair. Now the train will be moving from one station to another station. That our body and mind will be constantly engaged in action, whereas the Atman who is within self is always inactive, actionless. So that's how Ramana Maharshi has explained. So you can see a real yogi regards the self, the Atman, as actionless, even by being engaged in action. Activity belongs only to the body, the senses, the mind. Not activity belongs only to the body, the senses, and the mind, and does not affect the unchanging self. None of your activity, whatever you do, the sin, punya, righteous act, the merit, or the bad acts, papa, sin, anything not touch. How can you give an example? How can it not touch yourself, which is within, which is always pure? How can that be? Externally, you are doing so many things. Internally, the Atman will not be touched with any example. Take up the air. It will be moving. It will be blowing on the bad fragrance as well as the good fragrance. Durgandha and Sugandha. It will carry that also. Good fragrance to some places, sometimes it will be bad. But very next moment, the air is untouched. If you leave some other place and carry. So just if the vayu is untouched by external Durgandha or Sugandha, itself is pristine. Likewise, our Atman, which is within us, we may perform any good acts, bad acts, or any other type of acts, is untouched. So, activity belongs to the body, the sense, the mind. It does not in the least affect the unchanging self. So these are the knowledge of God, knowledge of Atman, which is given in Bhagavad Gita in the second chapter, Gnana Yoga, any other places in Bhagavad Gita you can find that. So what is the use of knowing about God or Atman? It is used for nididhyasana, shravana, hearing it first, manana, cogitating on that, then nididhyasana, meditating on that, becoming one with that. So it is can be used for meditation on your own self, which is pure, pristine, pure. Whatever might be the external samskaras, whatever might be the external nature, character, if you meditate on your pure nature, that is the Atman, it'll automatically make your body, mind, everything pure, your life becomes pure. So we have to hear about that Atman, meditate on that, nididhyasana. So what is the nature of Atman? Activity belongs to the body, the senses, and the mind, and does not in the least affect the unchanging self. The self is unchanging, actionless. So this is used for meditation. This is called the knowledge of Atman. Atmagnana, Brahmagnana. So Gnanapada, Gnana Marga in the Sankhya Yoga, this is stressed, the positive aspect. The positive aspect of the Atman or Paramatman is just taken care of. The rest is Maya, Mithya. Do not worry about all that unreal world. Always concentrate on the purity, the pure aspect of yourself, Atman. So that is being actionless. The Atman which is within you is actionless. And it is unchanging self, the Atman. Maybe in the activity, nature going out, outside. Your real self, the Atman which is within you, the God, the Parabrahma, Swarupa, is untouched. Unchanging self. Now, here, Bhagavad Gita is being quoted. The Bhagavad Gita says, Krishna tells in the Bhagavad Gita, great is the man, great is the man, controls the senses with his mind and engages them in selfless action. Great is the mind who controls the senses with his mind and engages them in selfless action. Where is it? Which is that it is in the third chapter, the seventh verse, and now dealing with that say very same verse in Bhagavad Gita, Karma Yoga on Wednesdays. Saturday we have a different chapter, that is the second chapter, but in the Wednesday Bhagavad Gita session, we are just explaining about this very verse, the seventh verse of the third chapter. So what a coincidence. So many times in our class we are seeing we have this coincidence. So let us see what Lord Krishna is telling in this third chapter, the seventh verse. So Lord, we will first chant that shloka for you, the third chapter, seventh verse. यस्त्विन्द्रियाणि मनसा नियम्यारभतेर्जुन कर्मेन्द्रियैः कर्मयोगम् असक्तः स विशिष्यते. यस्त्विन्द्रियाणि मनसा नियम्यारभतेर्जुन कर्मेन्द्रियैः कर्मयोगम् असक्तः स विशिष्यते. यः तु बट् हु इंद्रियाणि सेंस ऑर्गन्स manasa by the mind, niyamya controlling, asaktaha unattached, detached from those things, kandrihi by the organs of action, the motor organs, karma yogam, communion with God through work, doing the selfless work, karma yogam, arabdhe begins. Arjuna, O Arjuna, such a man, such a spiritual aspirant, a yogi, a karma yogi, vishishyati, excels. But he who controls all the senses, that is the Gnanendriya, eyes, ears, nose, tongue, skin, the pancha, the Gnanendriyas, organs of perception, there are different two categories of organs. Organs of perception, so these five sense organs, is Karmendriya, to which we do the actions, hands, feet, the organ of speech. Like that, we have another five motor organs, organs of action, which is called Karmendriya. So now you can understand this shloka better. But Lord Krishna, Sri Bhagavan Vacha, the blessed Lord is telling Arjuna, but he who controls all the sense organs, that is the organs of sense perception, Gnanendriya, by the power of his will, that is through the mind, that is Viveka, discriminative faculty, and becoming non-attached, lives a life of communion through dedicated action, such a person excels, is the best, excels in spiritual life. So this is told in contrast. This is the positive way. What is the effect, nature effect? But in the previous shloka, the sixth verse, Lord Krishna is telling what is not to be done. Here, what is to be done? Who excels? There it is, Karmendriyan Sayamya. Yaste manasasvan indriyartan vimuvatma vityacharas uchate. Lord Krishna is telling the nature of a hypocrite. What is that? Just now we saw one person externally was showing ecstasy, but the character was not good. So it's called a hypocrite. A person externally, you can't understand, but internally he is perfect, he has a good character. He is keeping in name God with his own atman, externally doing the selfless work. This karma yogi excels. So in that context, we'll go to that shloka to understand what is wrong, what should not do, what is hypocrisy, what is vyachara, karmendriyani sanyamya, ya asti manasasmaran indriyartham vimudatma mithyacharasya uchyate. That is the sixth verse of the chapter. He who remains organ of action is the Lord action. We give up all actions outside through the Kamendriya. The motor organ will not do anything. He will not give anything to the society. He will be quiet as if he is a great saint. But continues to brood. But within the mind, as if he is sitting in meditation, outside he put down so much of religious marks, so many other things, and so the world is great yogi, and he will close his eyes or will not do any action. But internally, in his mind, in his senses, he will be thinking of the sensual joys, meditating on the wrong things, the bad things, he is doing wrong things within. So he will be brooding in his mind over the objects of sensual desires, enjoyed through them. Such a deluded person is called a hypocrite. Then who is called a karma yogi, a real yogi? And here Lord Krishna is telling that in the seventh verse, but he who controlling all the sense organs by the power of the mind, by his viveka shakti, the discriminative faculty, and becoming non-attached. You should not, what is non-attachment? Non-attached to the fruit of work. You do the work, you are not attached to the fruit of work, but you are doing that as that work to please the Lord, Bhagavat Prityarthe. Such a person, such a yogi, lives the life of a communion through dedicated action, एंड सच ए पर्सन एक्सेल्स इन कर्म योग. सो दीज आर द टू वर्सेस वेयर लॉर्ड कृष्ण एक्सप्लेन्स हु इज एन हिपोक्रेट मिथ्याचारी एंड हु इज अ रियल कर्म योगी. And now you can see all that manifested in Sharadananda Ji Maharaj. What is that? Sharadananda was a glowing example of a person who could keep his mind in God. The same thing explained here by Krishna. Or the self, Atman. And at the same time, his hands at work, selfless action, communion with God and work. In the Gnanendriya is communion with God, mind, through the mind. The senses is always communing with God and self or Atman. But the hands and other motor organs are doing the work of God, selfless work, helping others, the work of the world, work of the society, of the nation. So that was Sharadananda. A real yogi regards the self as actionless even while engaged in action. Activity belongs only to the body, the senses and the mind, and it does not in least affect the unchanging self. The Bhagavad Gita says, great is the man, excels, savishishyate, who controls the senses with his mind by the willpower and engages them in selfless action. So monks tend to go into seclusion for meditation, giving up action. So now to them, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj would tell, monks always like to go to seclusion like Himalaya or in the caves or in the forest or on the bank of Narmada for meditation, giving up all actions. To them, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj told, remove your doubt forever, my boys, and remember what I say today, because Sharadananda Ji is telling out of experience. He has gone to the Himalayas, he has sat in meditation for many, many years, and he has done the Karma Yoga, he has done the selfless work, he has served the Guru, he has got realization after so much of experience. Now, at the fag end of the life, Sharadananda Ji is telling his disciples and other monks in the Ramakrishna order. The monks tend to go into seclusion for meditation to Himalayas, to the caves, on the bank of the river, giving up all actions. To them, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj said, remove your doubts forever, my boys, and remember what I say today. Those who will attain the summum bonum. What is summum bonum? The highest, the essence. Those who will attain the summum bonum here will also attain it there. And those who will not attain it here will never attain it there. By here and there, Swami Sharadananda meant karma yoga, work for the sake of God. We are introduced, especially the monks of Ramakrishna order are introduced by Swami Vivekananda not to run away from the society, not to go away from the society, who live on alms and begging and be dependent upon the society, but stay in the society, serve the society. So you will earn your own food, you will earn your own necessities by your work. You will not be getting it through the alms or begging, but you will depend upon yourself with your own work. But at the same time, you are not doing that work for the sake of the salary or any other purposes, but you are working for the sake of God and humanity, to serving the humanity. Not only you will be taking care of your food and clothing, basic existence, roti kapda or makhan, but also you will not take the salary, you will not take the money for your luxuries, but you will do that as a service to the Lord. You will be giving back to the society a lot. You'll be taking very less from the society, you'll be giving a lot to the society. But you are doing all these things as a dedication or offering to God. So that is true Karma Yoga. So now Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is telling the monks who are working in Ramakrishna order. So telling that whatever you are doing now, the work of Swami Vivekananda in the Ramakrishna order to serve the people, you'll be combining all four yogas, you'll be meditating, you'll be doing japa, you'll be doing puja, you'll be doing the work of the ashram, you'll be serving the people in the hospital, you'll be working in the garden, you'll be taking the nets, taking all that sale to do the sales in the market. All the work, all the karma yoga, all four yogas will be combined. So that karma yoga, what you are doing, is much, much greater and faster than if you go to some Himalayan caves and sitting there for meditation. Whatever you get there, you get the highest here too. So don't have any doubt about it. Swami Vivekananda has introduced that. So that is very, very important. So now let us hear the words of Swami Sharadananda clearly. Remove your doubts forever, my boys. And remember that I say today, those who will attain the Samam Bonam, what is Samam Bonam? The highest, the essence, that is God realization. Here, that is in Karma Yoga, doing the service of the humanity. What Vivekananda has introduced all the monks, don't go begging, don't live dependent upon the society or the people outside by begging and asking for this thing. Instead, earn your own living. Do the work of the society, but don't take the salary. Serve the society. That is Karma Yoga. So, what would the monks there do? They used to walk barefoot. They'll be walking here and there. They will do Madhukari Bhiksha, ask for alms. So, by that, they are exhausting their Prarabdha Karmas and the Sanchita Karma. Facing all the difficulties. But now, instead of negatively doing all that thing by begging and walking and going here and there by itinerant life, you are exhausting your karma. But instead, going away in a negative way, exhausting your karmas, why don't you do that as a society, service to the society? Then too, you are exhausting your karma. What is the goal? To exhaust your karma, Prarabdha Karma and the Sanchita Karma and the Agami Karma. So do that, staying in the society and doing service to the society, it will be positive, the society will be benefited, and the best crux of the society who want to renounce the world and realize God, the best crux of the salt of the society, if they go away from the society, then it will be a great loss to the society. So lead a detached life, live in the society, do the Karma Yoga as guided by Swami Vivekananda. You'll be getting the highest wherever you go. If you do sincerely the sadhana in the Himalayas, in the caves, the very same result, or even the highest you may get by doing this Karma Yoga. That's what Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is telling, Karma Yoga, by doing selfless work, keeping your mind in God, and doing the selfless work will yield the same result or the highest result, whatever would yield if you go there and sit in the Himalayas or in the caves and do that. So, remove your doubt forever, my boys, and remember what I say today. Those who will attain the Samam Bonam here will also attain all there, attain it there. And those who will attain it there, here, will never, those who will not attain it here, will not also attain there. But here and there, Swami Sharadananda meant work and seclusion. On another occasion, while in Puri Jagannatha in Orissa, he told a monk who was not well but nonetheless was anxious to return to work in his center. There was one monk, he had fallen sick. Because of his sickness, he couldn't work, but he was very eager and anxious. In spite of his disease, in spite of his ill health, he wanted to come back to the center instead of in the hospital or instead of in the bedridden state. He wanted to come back and start the work and do the work, selfless work. He didn't want to stay idle. So, to such a monk, now in Puri, Sharadananda ji is telling, look after doing such voluminous work in my life, I have this knowledge that we do nothing. We are not doing anything. We are just instruments. Everything happens according to the will of Master. Previously, I used to think that without me, this particular work would suffer. But during my absence, who would do this work? Now, I see, for want of anybody, the Master's work will not stop. Even if I am here or if I am not there, the Master will do his own work, whether now I hear Swatma Ramananda, I may stay in Johannesburg and do the work of building the temple or the ashrama, building up the ashrama, or doing all this human resource, collecting of human resource by doing these lectures. So do you think that the Lord needs me? No, not at all. I am being benefited and blessed by this opportunity of serving the Lord. The Lord doesn't need me. I need the Lord. I need the ashrama. So I am being blessed by doing all this work. If I am not there, maybe the Lord can do better work. He can take out better work from somebody else. He can bring a dog or a donkey and keep in my place, and he can do better work than me. So if I think egoistically that I am doing without me, this work will suffer, I am the foolish, the worst of the fools. The Lord does his own work. He doesn't need us at all. He has many, many, many spare parts. If I feel egoistic, then he will just replace with another spare part. He doesn't need us at all. Swami Vivekananda himself had told. Which Vivekananda? Nothing. Imagine the statement of Vivekananda. With just one foot dust, the feet of Ramakrishna can produce thousands and thousands of Vivekananda. With just one foot dust of Ramakrishna, he can produce thousands of Vivekananda. That is the case with Vivekananda. Then what with us? We are nobodies at all. So if we have an opportunity to do this work, then we are blessed. We should have an egoistic. So now, Sharadanandaji is giving us this wonderful knowledge. If we have come in contact with the Lord, the organization, and we are participating in that work, many times use the work of the squirrel saver. In Bangalore, they used to call it as Alilu Seva. Alilu means squirrel. The squirrel saver. The squirrel saw that Lord Rama was building a bridge in Sri Lanka. Where this war of the great Lake Annam, they were so strong, they were bringing in mountains, boulders. But the squirrel also wanted to join the work and help Lord Rama in the work of building and constructing the bridge. So it never stopped. It was not just thinking, what shall I do, how shall I work? No, it immediately started action. It went to the sea. It rolled its tail, you know, the tail of the squirrel in the water, sea water. It will dip it in the sand on the shore. It will collect so much of sand because of the very sea water in the tail. Then one pebble moves for hands and another pebble in the mouth. Small pebble, how much a squirrel can carry? So it will carry, put it onto the bridge, and then it will shake the tail, and so much of sand will get collected. So he started doing it, bringing in sand is required, small pebbles are required to build a bridge, not big. Stones are required, it needs small guppies and jelly and so many small stones, pebbles too. So he was doing his bit of work. And all these big waras were seeing this, it was obstructing their path, bringing the big waras, get lost from here. Squirrel to know how you want to serve Ramchandra, the Lord's bridge, the Lord's work. No, you are upsetting. Get away. The bonerous. That still few. You are about to fall down. And Ramchandra got hold of it. Ramchandra got hold of it. Crashed it. do not feel so high. That squid is also doing its own way. So it's okay with the attitude of the squid. He patted with his three fingers on the back of the squid. You find that only in India, that type of squid, and not there are so many varieties of squirrels in India in the forest. But that particular variety, which served Lord Namchand, the small squid, you see there is three marks on the back of the squid. Our parents, our elders, you show that at sea. The mark of the finger of Lord Ramachandra. Ramachandra was pleased by the work of the squirrel, helping in building the bridge. So he caressed it. So his finger marks are there permanently on the squirrel. So each time you used to see the squirrel, we used to remember the Ramakarya, Ram Seva. The squirrel Seva. That is called squirrel Seva in India. So we are doing our little bit. It's an opportunity given by the Lord for us. We should feel blessed. Lord doesn't need us at all. He can produce so many spare parts. If I feel egoistic, so that's what do these instructions. Sharadajima is taking him as an example. He's saying that for so many years I've done so much voluminous work, not ordinary work. All this work, I've done so much of work as the general secretary. Look here, after doing so much voluminous work in my life as a general secretary, and so many other way, not that. I have been this knowledge, he's giving his own experience. I've given this knowledge, Sharadananda is giving his own knowledge. What is that? After so much of experience, after so much of work, is telling that we do nothing. We think we are doing everything, we do nothing. We are only mere instruments. We are only instruments of the Lord. Everything is done by the Lord. Perfectly egoistic, O Manava, that you are doing everything. Without you, the family will not survive. Without you, your children will not survive. Without you, the company will not survive, the college will not survive, the hospital will not survive, the ashrama will not survive without you. No. Everything is done by the Lord. We are only instruments. Everything happens, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is telling, everything happens according to the will of Master. Previously, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj himself is giving his own example. Previously, I used to think that without me, this particular work would suffer. So when I was looking after the Ramakrishna Vidyarthi Mandir in Bangalore, many of the workers, the staff, the cooks, and some other people used to come and threaten me, leave the work and go away. I'll quit the work or do something like that. The students also sometimes. Then I used to tell smiling way. I would not hurt them by telling them to go away. Let's see, even if I am not here in this place as a head of the institution, the work of the institution can run better. I think that with me everything is going very well, but without me sometimes maybe the work may run better. I may be obstructing. So don't think the Lord needs you. We need the Lord. If I get angry, or if I think that without me the work will not go on, then we are the losers. So Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is telling, during my absence, who did this work? He himself is giving his own example, telling that during my absence, who would do this work? Now I see, for want of anybody, the master's work will not stop. There is a saying in England, especially during the British rule, especially the Queen's rule, the king is dead, long live the king, it is to tell. The moment the king died, the king is dead, long live the king. So the next king would come and take over the place, that king is gone, nobody will remember that king afterwards. So likewise, nobody will remember us we are blessed by doing the work of the Lord. So in his dealing with younger monks, right, Swami Asheshananda was an attendant, was the sevak of Sharadananda Ji Maharaj, was another direct disciple of Holy Mother Sharada Devi. Asheshananda, he writes, in his dealings with younger monks, Sharadananda, the Swami's love and forgiveness were limitless. One day, when I was with him at Puri, he told me he couldn't find the beads that he usually kept in a drawer. They belonged to the Holy Mother Sharada Devi, and I kept them after her Mahasamadhi with me. He said, they were strung on a golden thread. Probably somebody came and took them on account of the golden thread. While we were away seeing Lord Jagannatha at his temple, I was concerned. I thought perhaps I had accidentally thrown the rosary into the sea along with the flowers after evening worship. I returned to the beach and searched for a long time, but I couldn't find anything. The Swami came and consoled me. One by one, everything is going away. This is also will of the mother. What can be done, my son? Do not worry. See, now Sharadananda's great possession of that Japamala of Holy Mother, it was kept as a memorabilia, or just as a memory of that Divine Mother. But now this younger monk Asheshananda has lost it because of his carelessness. But Swami Sharadananda would not get angry. He is consoling him. Though he was very upset that wonderful Japamala of Holy Mother Sharada Devi is lost, the Swami consoled me. One by one, everything is going away. This is also the will of Mother. What can be done, my son? Do not worry. Others would have got angry. Such a precious gift of Holy Mother, I had kept it, preserved it, and you have lost it because of your carelessness. They could have punished him and thrown him out of the order because he was the General Secretary. Anything could be done for the as the General Secretary. He had that right. But see his heart. In his dealings with the younger monks, the Swami's love and forgiveness were limitless. This is what we have to learn. Forgiveness. Kshama. Kshama. Kshamaya Dharitri. Just like the earth, Mother Earth, we have to be all forgiving. That forgiveness is a great wealth which we have to learn. And Sharadananda Ji Maharaj's life is showing that thing. My Brahmacharya and Sannyasa Guru, revered Bhuteshananda Ji Maharaj, and my Mantra Diksha Guru was revered Tapasyananda Ji Maharaj, who was a disciple of Shivananda Ji, another direct disciple. My Brahmacharya and Sannyasa Guru, revered Bhuteshananda Ji Maharaj, was a disciple of Sharadananda Ji Maharaj. So my lineage goes like this on the Sannyasa side is Sharadananda Ji Maharaj, Paramaguru. Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha, Paramaguru Bhyo Namaha, Parapara Guru Bhyo Namaha, Parameshti Guru Bhyo Namaha. So my Paramaguru is Sharadananda Ji Maharaj. My Guru is for the Mantra Diksha, it is revered Tapasyananda Ji Maharaj. Paramaguru on the Mantra Diksha side is Shivananda Ji Maharaj. And Parapara Guru is Ramakrishna Paramahamsa himself. This side, Sannyasa and Mantra Diksha, my Guru is revered Bhuteshananda Ji Maharaj. This Guru, Paramaguru, is Sharadananda Ji Maharaj. So, revered Bhuteshananda Ji Maharaj, once in Bellur Math, when we were there in the training center, he told this incident. He had his Japamala with which he used to do every day, the Japamala. It was consecrated, or the Guru will do the Japa and make it pure, consecrated, and give it to the disciples so that you will keep it as a memory. So Bhuteshananda Ji Maharaj is using it For some reason, it was lost. Now, losing the Japamala given by the Guru is a great sin. So, we are so afraid, because the Guru Shishya relationship is very great, and you have lost the Japamala given by your Guru, touched by your Guru. So, Bhuteshanji Maharaj at the time was young. He went shivering, what will happen? What will happen to me? What will my Guru do? What will Sharadananji Maharaj do to me? Will he punish me? He was so afraid. He narrated this incident. He went and asked forgiveness. I've lost the Japamala which you gave. I misplaced it. What shall I do? He was shivering. Then Sharadananji Maharaj told, don't worry, my boy. What happened? If that is lost, it is gone. I will do japa, another Japamala, and give it to you. Don't be worried at all. He took another Japamala, did the japa, and gave it to him. It was the forgiveness. Bhuteshanji Maharaj told these incidents of the great forgiveness, that nature of forgiveness of Sharadananji Maharaj. Such a big heart. He personally told this when we were in Vellore Math in training center 1992. So Bhuteshanji Maharaj told about the greatness of Sharadananji Maharaj. So much of forgiving nature. So after hearing all these things, should we not develop that nature of forgiveness always? Is it just to hear, oh, Sharadananji was great, and keep quiet? No, we should also develop that. We should inculcate that in our life. So in his dealings with us younger monks, the Swami's love and forgiveness were limitless. One day I was with him in Puri Jagannatha. He told me he couldn't find the beads, the Japamala that he usually kept in his drawer. They belong to Holy Mother Sharada Devi herself, and I kept them in memory of her after the Mahasamadhi of Holy Mother Sharada Devi. They were strung with the golden thread. Probably somebody came and took away on account of the golden thread. So while we had gone to see the Lord Jagannatha, somebody might have stolen it. But now Asheshananda was concerned. I thought perhaps I had accidentally thrown the rosary into the sea along with the flowers which kept with the puja after evening worship. Maybe with the flower I have thrown this away into the sea. I returned and searched for a long time and found me. But the Swami consoled me. Just lost, he was in trouble. He consoled the Swami Asheshananda Devagama. So he was so much concerned and always worried, and also took care of his younger brothers. The Swami consoled me. It was very uncomfortable. One by one, everything is going away. This is also the will of the mother. What can be done? It's done. As Sharadananda grew older, he could no longer personally look after the health of the sick monks and devotees. Until he was strong, even in his old age, he used to go and look after and serve the sick monks and serve the monks of anybody who is always at the service, whoever might be sick. Immediately, Sharadananda, though in his old age, go and help them, nurse them, feed them, do all the labor to them, in spite of being a general secretary, in spite of being a great elder, and in his old age, he used to go and serve whoever might be the person who is sick. Now, he's growing very old. He could no longer personally look after the health of the sick monks and devotees. Not only monks used to serve the devotees, but still he showed his concern and gave his love and sympathy to all and everybody. One half some day after lunch, Sharadananda left Bodhan alone, which was unusual. So his attendant Asheshananda followed him. Sharadananda tried to discourage him from following him. He was going to visit Kokhali, a Parsi devotee. You know, the Parsi who come from Persia, Iran, and other people, they are called Parsis. They come from Iran during the Islamic invasion. They were fire worshippers, the Parsis. And the Islamic invaders invaded Iran, Persia. They all landed in India to protect the religion, the fire worship religion of Parsis. So they are staying in India, they are in shelter in India, they still thrive. A little population that other people are there, none of them are Tatars. So now He was a master devotee. So Shyamananda ji is going to him, and because he was alone, going alone, that in the bright sun, in the noon time after food, he was going to visit Kokhani, a prostitute who was dying, was in deathbed from advanced tuberculosis. At the time, tuberculosis or TB was fatal, no medicine. People who get tuberculosis will definitely die. No medicine at all. There are medicines, but then once somebody gets tuberculosis, that means you will die. And nobody will go near him because it is spreading. It will spread to the saliva or breathing because it, most of the time it goes to the lungs. So anything you touch of those belongings, so the virus or the bacteria, it can spread. It will also kill you. So once anybody will get tuberculosis in those days, the person will be isolated. All the food will be pushed from far. Nobody will go near him. Everything far off. Everybody will be isolated. So that's the condition of anybody getting tuberculosis in those days. No issue. So all have gone away from this person called Kokhani, a party. Shyamananda Maharaj, in that old age, very old, he started walking, and especially the scholar told, he encouraged him, don't come, because I'm going back. If you come, you are very young monk, you may get the disease too. For me, it is not to be cared of. I don't care for all those things. I'm going to serve him. So he went, he visited the Kokhani, a party devotee, he was dying from advanced tuberculosis. Sure, if you go sit with him, you will get the disease. And he was concerned about his attendant's health. Observing the attendants, urged Shyamananda alone to come along. They reached Sarang Street in central Calcutta, where that devotee, Pastor Devotee, was living on the second floor of the house. Kokhani was overjoyed because the time of death, the just before dying, is getting the company of that great monk, a direct disciple of Ramakrishna, in a small tattoo on the deathbed. The Swami in Sarang Street in central Calcutta, where the devotee was sleeping on the second floor of the house. Kokhani was overjoyed seeing Swami, but he continuously was coughing. The tuberculosis was for the lung, it can be for spine, it can be for the any other thing, bone. But this was for the lung, so he was continuously coughing. The cough can put out through the breath the bacteria, and you may be infected if you breathe that. So he was continuously coughing. Kokhani was overjoyed seeing the Swami, but he was continuously coughing, and he was also not careful about sanitary rules because he was on the deathbed. How can he follow the sanitary rules? So he was not careful about his touching the things or saliva or coughing. He continuously coughed. He was not careful about sanitary rules. He used his hands instead of his handkerchief when he coughed. Instead of a handkerchief or something, he was coughing with the hands, and with the same hand he's touching the Swami. So he was not careful about sanitary rules. He used his hands instead of his hand hanky when he coughed. Nevertheless, Shyamananda sat on his bed and comforted him by putting his hand on his head and caressing him. So now you can see he was not at all caring for his own life, but he was caring, he was very much concerned about the devotee's life. He might catch it. He's coughing. He's not following the sanitary rules. But he's not caring for his own life. No selfishness. His concern is only for the devotee. Kokhani, to a past devotee. So we will continue our reading about Shyamananda's great wonderful life of unselfishness. So many other great traits. We will continue that tomorrow, Monday. So now, if you have any questions or any doubts on what we had discussed today, you can ask questions on the live chat of the YouTube. There are no questions on the chat today. So now, any questions or doubts on the group life? Okay. Questions or doubts? will complete with the prayer. Om Kaksha Sarva Yajneshwaro Hari Asmantushte Jagatuttam Prinite Prinitam Jagat Hari Om Tatsat Shri Ramakrishna Arpanastu. Thank you. Om Namo Narayana.